What is up, people? I hope you're having a great day. In this video, I'm going to introduce to you demand. So what are we waiting for? And don't forget to subscribe and smash that like button during the song. There's a famous two-headed monster in economics known as supply and demand. And in this video, we're going to get acquainted with demand. Don't worry, he's a cute little guy. Before we get to demand, though, let's just spend a minute setting up the idea of markets. A market refers to something that brings together buyers and sellers, so it can be physical or it can be digital. We've talked a little bit about trade already, and markets facilitate trade. They help me trade an hour of my time teaching economics for something I want, like a delicious steak dinner. But I'm starting to get ahead of myself. A well-defined system of property rights is pivotal for the market system to work properly. People have to be confident that if they produce or buy something, that it's theirs and that nobody can take it from them without their consent. Additionally, it's vital to point out that people respond to incentives. An incentive provides a person with a reason to do something. Some incentives are monetary, but many are non-monetary. For example, time, laws, and regulations provide people with incentives to do or not do certain things. Like, I know this spot on my drive home where I drive slowly, because I know the 5-0 likes to post up and hand out speeding tickets.
It fooled me once. It fooled me, we can't get fooled again.
Prices also provide people with incentives. For example, if prices rise dramatically, we have an incentive to find something else instead of the thing that just got more expensive. Or if we still have to buy it, then we try to buy less of it than we would have if it had been cheaper. We'll also see how government regulations cause people to respond to incentives, though oftentimes it may not be in the way intended by the rulemakers. I have a feeling you're going to like demand. A lot of this lesson is quite intuitive. Let's start by defining our term. Demand is the willingness and ability to buy a good or service. Now, both parts have to be true. You have to want the thing, and you need to actually be able to buy it. A 9-year-old little boy might want to buy a Lambo, but unless kid is junior royalty, he probably doesn't have the ability, so he doesn't have any demand for the product. Okay, so far so good. Next up is something known as the law of demand, which states that price and quantity demanded are inversely related. As the price rises, quantity demanded falls, and as the price falls, quantity demanded rises. This is also quite intuitive. Think about it. Do consumers like high prices or low prices? Well, we like low prices. And when the price of something falls, we're more likely to buy it, or to buy more of it than we would have if the price was higher. There are two ways that we can illustrate this. The first is what's known as a demand schedule. A demand schedule is a table that shows the quantity demanded at different prices. It could look something like this. Now, this could represent my individual demand schedule for Skittles, and as we already established, my quantity demanded is higher at lower prices than it is at higher prices. But I'm just one person, so what about everybody else? Well, they also have their own demand schedules for Skittles. By the way, of course I realize, we don't walk into a store with exact numbers like this saying, if Skittles are $1, I'll buy 2 packs. But we behave as if we do. So even if this is overly precise, it does a pretty good job explaining consumer behavior. So we also have a market demand schedule, which includes everybody's preferences for Skittles. And guess what? The law of demand still holds. Consumers buy more at lower prices. However, in any economics class, this isn't usually how we're going to look at demand. 98% of the time, we're going to graph it. Our vertical axis is price, and our horizontal axis is quantity. And we're gonna draw a demand curve that matches the information. And what we have here is our first demand curve. Notice that it's downward sloping. And if you're taking notes, you don't need to draw it with all of these specific prices and quantities. You can draw it like this with variables. So what causes us to move from point A to point B? The price decreased, causing us to increase our quantity demanded. This is known as a change in quantity demanded. Our demand hasn't actually changed. The demand schedule and the demand curve both show us our current preferences for the good at all possible prices. If the price is P1, then we want Q1 units. and if the price falls to P2, we'll buy more. The only thing that determines what quantity we'll actually buy is the price. When the price changes, it causes a change in quantity demanded. On our demand curve, this causes a movement along the demand curve. An upward movement indicates that the price has risen and that we decrease our quantity demanded, while a downward movement indicates that the price has fallen and this increases our quantity demanded. This part is super important. The only thing that causes a change in quantity demanded is a change in the price of the good. If it sounds like I'm making a big deal about this, I am. It's really important to know the difference between a change in quantity demanded, which is what we just did, and a change in demand, which is coming up next. All right, so this part of the lesson is all about, okay, but what causes our demand for something to actually change? As in, the price tomorrow is the same as the price today, but our demand for the good increases or decreases. There's actually something really important in what I just said. The reason our demand changes must be something besides a change in the price of the good. A change in the price does not change our demand. It changes, say it with me, the quantity demanded of the good like we just discussed. We have five basic reasons that our demand for something will change. We can use the acronym TRIBE as a mnemonic to help us remember it. A change in tastes and preferences, change in the price of related goods, a change in income, a change in the number of buyers, and a change in expected future prices. Okay, so let's break each of these down a little bit further. Tastes and preferences refer to something becoming more or less popular. Remember when skinny jeans were in? Well, they're not anymore, so the demand for them has decreased. It's not about the price of skinny jeans. It's that people's tastes and preferences have shifted away from skinny jeans. When something becomes more popular, we'd say that the demand increases. A change in the price of a related good also causes a change in demand. Now, this one needs a little bit more explanation. We have two types of related goods, substitutes and complements. A substitute is a good that buyers see as similar to another good. For example, let's take Sprite and 7-Up. They're both lemon-lime soft drinks. Now, we might prefer one over the other, but roughly speaking, they're pretty similar. Let's call Sprite good A and 7-Up good B. If the price of Sprite were to double, what do you think would likely happen to demand for 7-Up? It would increase. Why? Because when the price of Sprite increased, people substituted away from the good that became relatively more expensive, and they demand more of the other one, even though the price of 7-Up didn't change. So we can formally say that if A and B are substitutes, and the price of good A rises, we will demand more of good B. On the other hand, if the price of good A falls, we will demand less of good B. Complements are goods that consumers use together. Think of all the great combos: cereal and milk, peanut butter and jelly, a gaming console and games. If the price of a gaming console falls, what will happen to demand for games? Well, demand for games will increase, even though the price of games hasn't changed. What changed is that now more people will buy the console, because it's cheaper, and once we buy the console, well, we will buy games, because what good is a console with no games? Why have a ballroom with no balls? So if we call the console good A and games good B, we can say that if the price of A falls, the demand for B increases. And when the price of A rises, the demand for B decreases. Okay, next up is a change in income, and this one is pretty straightforward. Most goods are normal goods, meaning that when our income rises, the demand for the good also rises. On the other hand, there are other goods known as inferior goods, which means that when people's income rises, the demand actually falls. Now, I know that sounds kind of weird, but think about it. If a person loses their job, they still need to buy food, right? They probably buy cheaper food than they normally would. Maybe they buy generic brands instead of name brand, that kind of thing. So for inferior goods, our demand increases when our income falls. But the vast majority of goods are normal goods, why we call them normal, and when our income rises, so does our demand. A change in the number of buyers will also change the demand for a good. And this one is also pretty straightforward. If the number of buyers increases, so does demand. And if the number of buyers decreases, well, you guessed it, so does demand. Lastly, a change in expectations about future prices will affect demand as well. Let's say I'm on StockX and I see a pair of Dunks and I'm trying to decide if I should cop. Well, if I expect the same shoes to be even more expensive in the future, then my demand today increases because I want to get the shoes before the price goes up. On the other hand, if I hear from my cook group that the price of these shoes is about to drop in the next couple of weeks, well, then my demand today decreases because I'd rather go ahead and wait and buy them when they become cheaper. Hey, StockX, if you appreciate the shout, send some J's over to your boy. Okay, so those are our demand determinants, but what does it look like on the graph? When demand changes, this causes a shift of the demand curve. The entire demand curve shifts to the right or to the left. When demand increases, the demand curve shifts to the right. Notice how this shows that at any given price, there's a greater quantity demanded. Again, this illustrates that the shift must have been caused by something other than a change in the price. When demand decreases, the demand curve shifts to the left. A kind of goofy memory aid for this is Ertl the Turtle. Increase right, decrease left. That mnemonic will serve you well all year long. All right, well, that's it for demand. Next up, demand's even cuter sister, supply. Until next time, this has been a LaMoney production. Thanks again for watching, and please hit that like button if you didn't already, and be sure to check out the description for links to the answers to the practice questions and some of the great study aids like Econ and 250 Words that I've made for you. See you in the next video.